Welcome to News All Day, everybody. I'm Shannon Ferry in for Rochelle Boone. So glad you're with us on this very busy news day. Also coming up, we have brand new data into our newsroom regarding city school enrollment and admissions. The headline here, enrollment numbers are slipping. Education reporter Jillian Jorgensen will break it all down for us. And we've got a real treat for you on this Women's Wednesday. Comedian, producer, author, and star of the hit sitcom Bob Hart's Abishola, Gina Yashere, is here to share her wisdom about facing challenges no matter what your dreams are. Meteorologist John Davitt here now with a check of your forecast. And what do we give today, John? I mean, it's
We're looking great.
We're looking great.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're hot, but we're looking great.
Yeah, humidity's not bad, but we got a decision tonight. Beethoven or baseball? The Yankees are playing. Looking pretty good, Shannon. And are you engaged mentally? Are you ready? We got a little word scramble. Don't answer now. At the end of the show.
I'm already seeing it, I think.
Ooh, you're quick.
I'm not saying it's easy. I'm just saying I think I might see it.
All right, well, we'll
see it
have this all hour.
Okay, I'll think about it. Thanks, John. Mayor Eric Adams has formally endorsed Governor Kathy Hochul in her election bid. He says they share the same priorities like improving public safety and making New York more affordable. The governor is facing two challengers in the upcoming Democratic primary, Congressman Tom Suozzi and public advocate Jemani Williams. Political reporter Emily Ngo was there for the announcement. And Emily, we expected this, but what more can you tell us from inside the room?
Hi, Shannon. Good afternoon. There was a lot of love for labor unions here at the head. Has a close relationship with the mayor, but the mayor chose to endorse Hochul 3 days ahead of the start of early voting, just 2 weeks shy of primary day. We should note also that while the lieutenant governor and governor candidates run separately in the primary, Kathy Hochul's running mate, Antonio Delgado, did get the endorsements today of the Hotel Trades Council and 32BJ. And that is the very latest from here in the Flatiron District. Shannon, I'll send it back to you.
And we'll be watching that early voting closely as well. Emily, thanks so much. The correction department was able to avoid a federal takeover of Rikers Island, at least for now. City officials will now get an extra few months to solve a number of ongoing issues that we have been reporting here as well at the troubled jail complex. Alyssa Pallicelli joining us now with more on this new timeline. Hi, Alyssa.
Well, Shannon, the key phrase from this federal judge is for now. For now, a federal takeover of Rikers Island will be avoided.
The Federal Reserve is expected to announce its largest interest rate hike in nearly 30 years to combat inflation. The central bank is considering a short-term rate increase of 0.75 percentage point, in addition to a previous rate hike on mortgage rates back in March. Some economists are now warning this accelerated series of rate hikes will increase the likelihood of a recession in the next year. City public school enrollment and admissions data for the 2021-2022 school year has been released, and we know enrollment has dropped. Education reporter Jillian Jorgensen here to break down some of the information. So we have been hearing about this, not as many students signing up for city schools, but what do these numbers tell us now?
So these numbers show us that enrollment is down this year in New York City public schools, which is something that pandemic hit the city's public schools. That's a large amount of students who have left.
It's a large amount of students, and then we saw this with the budget, all the negotiating, and teachers don't really seem to have gotten what they wanted. I also want to talk to you about the data that has come out about specialized schools, because that's another topic that you have been covering. The admissions criteria has been a subject of debate for years. Tell me what it's looking like now.
So we're looking at numbers from the specialized high schools, schools like Stuyvesant, Brooklyn Tech. Needs to be seen what, if anything, might happen to try to change these numbers.
I mean, the school year is winding down. Just curious, because we have a little bit more time left with you. Where do we go from here? I mean, admission continues to go down. You have these teachers that are not happy with the amount of money that their schools are getting. Some of them might even be relocated because of the budget. Where do we go from here?
Yeah, it's a really good question. You know, the enrollment trend seems to be continuing downward. We got a little glimpse of what next year will look like in terms of offers to students who applied to high school or middle school. That's down too. There are fewer kids applying for seats in these anymore. That means programs go away. That could mean class sizes get bigger. And that's not necessarily a recipe for getting parents to come back to a school they may have left.
No, and it's already hard enough for a student to switch out of a school potentially, then go back. So they'd really have to be offering something good to do it. Jillian, thank you so much for breaking this down for us. John Devitt back now with a look at your forecast. And we have a hot day on tap, so it's time to put that sunscreen on, get your sunglasses on, because it's a hot one.
And it's tough for those kids in classroom looking out at the blue skies, just waiting for school to end, especially so close to school
being out. We're so close.
Yeah, all right, it's a tough one. It's a good day to take your class outside. I always enjoy those great sunshine both days and nice and comfortable, Shannon.
Nice for Father's Day, yeah.
Yes. Uh-huh.
All right, thanks, John. And speaking of weather, we have some important information for those of you looking for a way to cool off this summer. That is coming up. And also saying goodbye to a popular web browser, one that many say defined an era for internet users. Why the company says it is time to move on. And later, you've seen her on TV, you've seen her on stage, and now she will be joining us right here on set at New York One, Jeannie Ashere, here to talk about everything from her new book to her upcoming gig here in the city. Welcome back. The Supreme Court released several decisions today on health care and immigration, but it has yet to unveil their much anticipated rulings on abortion and gun legislation. Kevin Fry here with the latest on today's rulings and when we can expect these landmark rulings. Kevin, we have been refreshing the page, you know, right as soon as 10 o'clock comes around, refreshing to see when this is going to come down, because the reaction to those specifically will be really intense, we expect.
Yeah, it's like a fire drill every day when we wait to see exactly what the Supreme Court is going to announce. We are now in yet another waiting zone as we just wait to find out when the next decision day is, let alone when we might get these two big cases for New Yorkers. When it comes to what we did actually find out today, there were a handful of cases, including one dealing with reimbursements for medical facilities in some lower income areas. The court ruling the federal government was inappropriately reducing the reimbursement for certain drugs. There was also a case dealing...
Speaking of what Kevin just mentioned there, the House Select Committee investigating the January 6th attack on the Capitol will hold the third public hearing tomorrow. Lawmakers canceled today's hearing due to technical issues. Now, tomorrow, the panel is set to describe former President Donald Trump's efforts to persuade Vice President Mike Pence to illegally delay the electoral count or for him to object to President Biden's win as he presided over the certification. Well, today marks the 10-year anniversary of DACA, or Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. That is the Obama-era program allowing undocumented immigrants brought to the U.S. as children to apply for driver's licenses, social security numbers, and work permits. Over the last decade, the policy has assisted more than 600,000 dreamers, and some of them speaking out today in Battery Park. That is where we find our Victoria Mana. They are marking the occasion with some elected officials and advocates. Hi, Victoria.
Yeah, hey there, Shannon.
All right, Victoria, thank you so much. And later today, the Rent Guidelines Board will hold a second in-person hearing before it votes on potential increases for rent-stabilized apartments. The hearing will take place between 4 and 9 p.m. at the Hosto Center on the Grand Concourse in the Bronx. Here is what's on the table. For one-year leases, an increase anywhere between 2 and 4%. For two-year leases, a 4 to 6% increase. These hikes would affect lease renewals that start on October 1st. And how about this? The New York Philharmonic's Concert in the Park series is back. Last night, New Yorkers were sprawled out in Van Cortlandt Park for the orchestra's first park concert since 2019. And after 2 years of pay cuts and canceled concerts, musicians' salaries are back to pre-pandemic rates. And as we go ahead and get a look outside for you, conditions are shaping up to be perfect for tonight's concert on the Great Lawn in Central Park. Look at that sky there. Temperatures will peak near 80 degrees this afternoon and skies will stay clear. Looking ahead, there is a chance for storms tomorrow. And for Friday, we heat up to 90 degrees. John will be back in just a few minutes with more details on the forecast. All right, does this sound familiar to you, bring back memories for you? It's time to say goodbye to Microsoft's once popular web browser. Why Internet Explorer officially headed into retirement? That's coming up. Well, Welcome back, and boy, is this the end of an era. Today is the last day of Internet Explorer. Microsoft will no longer be supporting the once dominant browser, which has been live for 27 years. The company has been pushing users to use their new browser, Edge, which launched in 2015. Today, Google Chrome is the favored Internet browser used by roughly 65% of people online. Now, here's Karina Mitchell for more business news.
To you by BetMGM.
Two stellar outings for New York pitchers and the Yankees, and the Mets put another W in the books in the Bronx. Gerrit Cole bounced back from a tough start last week in Minnesota. He struck out seven raised bats over six scoreless innings. The Yankees can in the fourth thanks to a throwing error by Tampa Bay. Bombers win 2-0. Both teams are back for round two tonight at 7. Last night at Citi Field, Chris Bassitt threw eight scoreless innings against the Brewers, striking out seven. The Mets scored three runs in the bottom of the first, and that's all they need. They shut out Milwaukee 4-0. Tonight's game also at 7. A nationwide lifeguard shortage is forcing the city parks department to cancel many of its summer swim programs. Programs like Lap Swim, Senior Swim, and Learn to Swim at outdoor city pools this year will not be available. Here is what the mayor had to say about the situation during his earlier appearance on Mornings on One.
We just saw recently the death of two young people, and I was a part of advocating for Swim Strong. We're going to examine that. I'm going to reach out to parks and figure out how can we continue the instructions. We have to have young people learn how to swim.
The outdoor pool season is set to begin on Tuesday, June 28th. Just ahead, she is an actor, comedian, and author, and she is joining us right here on News All Day. Gina Yashere taking us on her journey to stardom. But first, speaking of journeys, the story of one woman who went from TV news anchor in Ukraine to an unemployed refugee, all to save her children. How she navigated her family's escape from the war-ridden country to Brooklyn. That is coming up on News All Day. Gorgeous shot there. Welcome back to News All Day, everybody. Let's go to Anthony now for the latest on some of the day's developing stories.
Shannon, thanks. Good afternoon, everyone. Here is what we're following. Police are searching for two suspects after a teen was...
We have been talking about it all day. Coming up tonight, the three Democratic candidates for lieutenant governor will take the New York One debate stage ahead of the June 28th primaries. Political anchors Errol Lewis and Susan Arbetter will be moderating. And here with me now to talk more about it, political director Bob Hart for a preview. Bob, there is a lot that we are looking for tonight. But first of all, what do you think we can expect tonight?
Well, it's fun to have our Albany political team here.
Yeah.
And you know, it's just
a big reunion.
It's a little bit of like a Super Bowl. I think this is going to be sort of a proxy ideological fight of where the Democrats are in New York State right now. You have Anna. So I think it's going to be where the Democrats stand. It won't just be about like what it is like to be lieutenant governor. It's going to be about the state of the Democratic Party in New York, and it's very divided.
Do we feel that Antonio Delgado is going to be the focus of much of this debate? I mean, he has definitely been the most visible, at least, in this race.
I would think so. He's Kathy Hochul's running mate, but everyone is independent in a primary in the lieutenant governor's ballot, and that's why they have their own debate. So I think he will be the focus of the attack, and he'll be sort of used as a proxy for Governor Hochul. And it also sort of a coming out party for him politically. Most of us in New York have not really heard from him before because he was a congressman upstate. This is a real chance for him to try out in front of all of us.
Anna Maria Archila, it's interesting because she got kind of these high-profile endorsements, but will that be enough? How important is tonight for someone like her?
Well, a lot of it, this is such a cliche, it's all depends on turnout. If turnout is low, she has a progressive base that could help her sneak in. I mean, Delgado, you would have to say, is a slight favorite because he's so important for all of them.
And you touched on this. It's really people presenting their case to voters because we haven't really had any large-scale polling on a race like this.
We don't know at all. Exactly right. It's sort of a jump ball. And listen, you know, Diana Reyna, she has been elected to the city council. She's known in New York City. New York City is with a Democratic base in New York. You just never know with a low turnout race potentially like this who could sneak in and win.
Do you want to ask you, we talked to Emily earlier about Mayor Adams endorsing Hochul. Does this really make a difference? We expected it. It's a little late, though, would you say?
It is late, and it's sort of, I mean, on the one hand, you're like, well, of course the governor and the mayor, of the electorate, this helps her with it, with the mayor, and also the idea that, you know, Jemani Williams is a public advocate, known in New York. Maybe this bites into his base a little bit.
He was quick to point out earlier on Mornings on One, the mayor also, you know, I talked to Jemani, and we're okay, but I'm sure Jemani was wishing that he had support from the mayor.
Absolutely.
Yeah. All right, so we will be watching closely, and we can't wait. So thank you for previewing this, Bob. Again, make sure you tune in tonight at 7 to watch the three Democratic candidates for lieutenant governor. They will go head-to-head only here on New York One. You can tune in, of course, on New York One and also on the Spectrum News app. A Ukrainian husband and wife with three children were lucky enough to escape the war that is tearing their country apart. They landed in Brooklyn in an attempt to build a better life for their family. And as Borough reporter Rebecca Greenberg reports, the nonprofit Hebrew Public is providing the support that they need. All right, Rebecca, thanks so much. John Davitt back now with a look at the forecast. We have a sunny streak.
Yep.
It's not going to last forever.
No, it can't, right?
All good things must come to an end, but...
tomorrow, that's when it ends.
Yes.
But it's not so bad. Let's go take a look. So this is tomorrow, and this is the chance of rain. And take a look. The highest chance of rain is really during the morning hours. So a lot of your day is going to be dry. So get this out of the way in the morning. We'll end that sunny streak, but overall not so bad. And the timing is good because we need it to be dry tonight. New York Philharmonic, first time in 2 years. That we're going to be out on the great lawn, and it's going to be nice. 65 to 72, breeze, smartphones charged. So, Shannon, the sun's got a lot of power.
All right, John, thank you so much.
All right.
And stay tuned for this, John, because coming up after the break, we will be hearing from the hilarious comedian, Gina Yashere. She is here in studio. Hey, Gina. She will be talking about her memoir about being included in the new Netflix special honoring LGBTQ comedians. We have so much to talk about. You don't want to miss it. We will be right back.
You told me I was making the biggest mistake of my life. I was supporting you with honesty.
That is comedian and actor Gina Yashere, starring in the hit CBS sitcom Bob Hart's Abishola. She is also the author of Cat Candid, a funny, pointed memoir that tells the story of her journey from growing up in England as a gay woman of Nigerian descent and ending up in America as a star. It is so great to have you here.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And it's Women Wednesday, so you come on a very special day for us.
Good day to
here
be
at the
here.
Show. Congratulations on all the success on the sitcom, because you're coming back for season four. And all of this happened with COVID. I mean, I'm sure that was a huge feat, feeling like you got through this with all of those problems.
Yeah. We were shooting all through COVID, testing every day, everybody wearing masks, but we made it through.
We made it through.
We got all 22 episodes done this season, so yes to us.
Yes to you. And the way that you got this show, you have to explain to the viewer. It's pretty wild.
I mean, I got a call out of the blue from my agent saying, I was living in New York at the time. I lived here for 6 years. And I get a call out of the blue saying, Chuck Lorre wants to meet you. And so basically, the Tonight Show, Def Comedy Jam, all the wonderful things I've done. And they went, oh, no, we typed Nigerian female comedian into Google.
I mean, however you get the job, right? whatever it does. But Chuck Lorre, a legend. I mean, that's incredible still.
Yeah,
and the fact that you had this background to pair with it.
Oh, it's fantastic. You know, I sit next to him, and if I could crawl into his brain and just download everything he knew, I would. But yeah, I'm constantly learning. We're making a fantastic show, which is needed in this current climate. So I'm very grateful.
This was not always the path for you. We heard in that little bit, your mom was very set on you becoming a doctor. You chose the disgrace to the family. But even before that, you didn't at first, because you were working as an elevator engineer.
Yes, I was supposed to be the doctor in the family, but then I got to advanced level biology at school, where we had to cut open a rat. And I fainted. So I discovered then that the sight of blood is not going to work with the doctor ambitions. So I switched to engineering. So my mum then turned to my younger brother and was like, okay, you will be the doctor. She's the engineer, you'll be the doctor. And so I became an engineer. I was electrical electronics engineer. I worked for Otis Elevators, building and repairing elevators. I was the first woman engineer that Otis UK had ever had in their 100-year history, and did that for a few years. But then I left that to do comedy. And my mum was not impressed. So my mum was like, well, you're leaving engineering to become a clown. So, no. Yeah, it did not work. She was not happy.
I'm sure she enjoys it now.
Oh, I got on television within 6 months. And then she was like, oh, yes, my daughter, the clown. I always knew she was going to be a clown. Yeah.
Well, we love when the story ends well. Also, the book. Got to talk about the book.
Yes.
You worked on this in the pandemic.
I wrote it in the pandemic.
I guess a good time. It's a productive way to spend your pandemic. Right,
exactly. You know, I was in my house quarantined, and I was like, well, I've got this book to write. Let me just get to it. So I wrote the whole thing over the pandemic.
Also, something else we have to talk about is we are talking about your upbringing a lot.
Oh, yes.
And how, you know, your mom didn't know that you were going to... you're a huge success now, so she's so excited about it. But when you look back at your life, the journey, the twists and turns, I mean, what is your message to your younger self, the younger people watching you? We are celebrating Pride Month, and I know that that is also something that you coming out with something of a journey for you as well.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's all about, for me, talking to my younger self, I just say, keep going. It's all about perseverance. Be yourself. Do not worry about what other people think of you, and don't try to fit yourself into boxes that other people have created. Just be yourself. I mean, so it took a long time to learn that. So read my book, and then you don't have to take as long as me to learn it. So yeah, the book is just my journey from, you know, being born of immigrant parents in England, that journey to live my dream in America.
Yeah,
I'm
I
here.
Mean, England, because you were huge in England,
yeah,
and then you decided to come here. So
yeah.
you like in that New York City. Well, now you're in New York City, but you live in L.A.
Yeah.
You've dealt with all the cities, but
is England
still your heart, or you love us here?
Oh, listen, I'm always going to be a London girl at heart.
Yeah.
Like, I've even got the pendant to prove it.
Yeah.
So I'm always going to be a London girl. That's where I'm from. That's where I sat. You know, listen to my voice. I've been in America for 15 years. This accent is not changing.
No.
This is who I am. But, you know, the dream has always been to be here. You know, as a kid watching American TV shows and watching Melrose Place, that was my dream. And so I made it here. Just go where your heart takes you.
And we have Little Island tonight.
Oh, yes.
Tomorrow night. I'm sorry. Tomorrow
night.
I was getting excited for it. I'm thinking it's tonight. Because I was thinking of your Instagram. You were scoping out the scene on Instagram yesterday.
Yeah, I'm here in New York. I'm performing at Little Island tomorrow night. It's going to be a really fun show. That auditorium, that outdoor auditorium, looks amazing. So I'll be there, and I'll be at the Comedy Cellar on Friday. I'm hitting all my favorite New York spots.
We are so glad to have you here. It is so good to be with you, and hopefully we will get some clips from your show.
Oh, most definitely.
we can talk about that. The book is out there. Gina, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
We will be right back, so stay with us.
All right.
And so, yes, I was totally stalking on IG. Ooh, look at that. Time for our picture of the day. Check out this incredible view from last night's strawberry moon over Lower Manhattan. If you have a picture that you would like to be featured, just use the hashtag MY1PIC. You know, I heard you talking about this on the morning show earlier, John. Why are we calling it a strawberry moon when it doesn't look like a strawberry?
Because this
Everyone wants to know. This
is the month where strawberries are harvested. So June is when the strawberries are ready. So that's why we call it the strawberry moon.
It looks more like a sunrise surprise, golden moon.
I don't know. Sunrise surprise. Their picture is way better than my picture. That's about the best I could
Listen,
do.
Listen, you tried your best. You tried.
Yeah, some of our viewers sent in shots too. Here's one from Chris. That one looks kind of good. Here's Leon, New York One super fan, with a shot from Queens. That one is nice. And Dr. Karina looks good here. All right, Shannon, it is time for the weather scramble. Don't answer yet. Take a look. I'm going to do a couple graphics. We'll come back. So you got about 20 seconds before you're going to have to give your answer. So this is what you've got outside right now. Sunny out there, and that's the way it's going to stay all afternoon. Looking great. Take a look. Temperatures in the 70s. Definitely breezy, but overall looking very, very nice. All right. Air quality, that's a bright spot too. Only at 51 hundredths when we start to talk about air pollution levels being extreme. So we're good there. And the humidity, nice and comfortable in the pleasant zone. Enjoy this. You know that New York City humidity will be here before you know it. So tonight's a good one, 69 degrees. Tomorrow, we've got some scattered showers around in the morning. And on the extended forecast, we're going to be hot for Friday. All right, Shannon, here we go. What do you got? What do you think it is?
Is it summer solstice, John?
Well, what happens on Tuesday? It is, in fact, the summer solstice. Very good. All right, hopefully.
You were easy with me on this one. I know. You've had some really tricky ones over the years.
That's all right.
You stumbled me, so I appreciate you going.
Well done.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Pedro Alvarado is living the classic American dream. He came to New York from Venezuela, and after 2 decades of learning the service industry and saving money, he now has his own business. Here's Alyssa Palicelli with why his Queens Bar opened just in time for Pride Month.
Thank you.
This is the moment Pedro Alvarado's dream became a reality. The cut of a pink
is like encouraging.
In Queens, Alyssa Palicelli, New York One.
All right, thank you, Alyssa, and thank you, Queen. Hip-hop fans, you might want to listen up for this one. The lineup for Rolling Loud New York has been announced, and this rap icon and fellow New Yorker tapped to headline. Yep, that is Nicki Minaj, and she, along with ASAP Rocky and Future, will lead the 3-day music festival. It is taking over Citi Field this September. Tickets, though, go on sale on Friday. So if you want them, go ahead and get them. That is going to do it for us on this day of news all day. I'm Shannon Ferry in for Rochelle Boone. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.